disarm Officer Middleton and had to do all of these things to secure Officer Middleton and the firearm and remove her from the altercation. And then later, Officer Middleton came forward and said, I was never assaulted by Mr. Landau. Mr. Landau never touched my firearm or made any efforts or moves towards my firearm. Now we've got five officers, and we've got the officer who I allegedly tried to disarm, who all have conflicting testimony. They couldn't even be represented by the same attorneys in my criminal proceedings. So a week before my trial, my case was dismissed. I get a call from my public defender about a week later. I just got out of class, and he said, the case has been dismissed, and you can call back if you have any questions. And that's what it was for me. Was as soon as I got out of jail, I had a life. I had to jump right back into it. I had to start going to school. I had to put food in the fridge, go to work, so on and so forth. And my first semester of spring, and my first day of class is spring semester, my first semester on college campus, I had to attend 45 stitches. That's how it was. You can't let the system get you. That's what the system does. It removes you in your outside life. In this case, I had to jump right back into that slot and just keep going. And that's really what led me to where I'm at now. After that call came through and I realized my case had been dismissed, my attorney told me I was free to procure civil repercussions if I'd like, and if I had a question, I'd give him a call. And I thought it would be easy. I'm sitting there, I've got this dismissal, and I've got all of this conflicting data in this case file that I've been compiling. I've got these horrible pictures, and I kid you not, I spoke to almost 30 civil firms, and nobody wanted to pick up the case. Nobody wanted to pick up the case. I'm not even sure how many firms actually read the case, because on the surface, what they saw was a black male who allegedly criminally attempted to disarm a police officer and was beaten almost to death because of it. The reason I work so well so often, because if law enforcement says that their life is at risk, they can use whatever means necessary to subdue an individual, to beat you to death with a rock they picked up on the side of the road. And if they can say that their life is in jeopardy and this is what they resorted to, then that can be justified, and that happens all the time. So, in my particular case, it wasn't until I met John Homer, and there were periods where I was incredibly depressed. I was just happy to be alive. I was happy I was able-bodied. I was happy I was on campus. I was learning. I didn't have serious impairment. But I knew we're moving forward. And one of the things my professors told me a week before she was hit by a drunk driver was that I shouldn't give up on justice for myself, that I deserved enough money to come back and buy this campus. And then she was killed at the end of the week. So I just printed off numbers. Started calling them and crossing them out. No one wanted to take the case. I finally found John Holland Edwards and Roseman. He spent a couple weeks reviewing all the paperwork and finally called me back and said, you need to get in here. You need to get in here. When we hit the city, and we were able to hit the city this hard at this particular moment, because they didn't have a mayor. They were running on an interim mayor. The police chief had just been fired. Manager of safety had just resigned. Wasn't really any head administrative figure to point fingers at, and we hit him with this lawsuit. And at the time, it was the fourth largest settlement in Denver's history for police abuse, just involving police. Now it's the ninth. And that, I think, speaks magnitude to the issue at hand. And that's why I'm a frontline organizer, primarily against law enforcement and justice, clearly having an understanding that intersectionality is a key component to dismantling oppression, right? Understanding that people in the LGBTQ community, people in the black, brown, indigenous communities, and the poor communities are suffering from some of these same injustices that people like myself have experienced. And so, I'm not really sure where we're at with time. We can open it up for Q&A.
So we had a minor change of plans. Jibrael Dibble will not be joining us tonight, but we do have a very talented Samantha Cush. So please welcome her. just going to read a poem called Equality by Maya Angelou. Equality. You declare me, you see you did me. Through a glass which you do not shine. Though I stand before you boldly, trim and rake and make your time. You do all to hear me faintly, as a whisper out of range. While my drums beat out a message, and the rhymes never change. Equality, and I will be free. Equality, and I will be free. You announce my ways are waiting, and that I fly from man to man. But if I'm just a shadow to you, could you ever understand? We have lived painful history. We know the shameful past. But I keep on marching forward, and you keep on coming last. Equality, I will be free. Equality, I will be free. Take the blindness from your vision. Take the padding from your ears. And confess you heard me crying, and admit you see my tears. Hear the temple so compelling. Hear the blood drop through my veins. Yes, my drums are beating nightly, and the rhymes never change. Equality, I will be free. Equality, I will be free. Thank you.
Officers that involved murder, Nixon, Wilson, those who don't know? Certainly, yes. So, my particular case, actually, they were never disciplined. And the way it works is there's a discipline matrix that is totally separate from any sort of investigation done by the district attorney's office. So the discipline matrix that deputies and police officers subjected go through in Denver is strictly around policy, and violation of policy, whether or not people acted within set parameters. The district attorney almost immediately came out and decided that the officers acted within policy and there weren't going to be any criminal charges at the file. Within the past 11 years, actually, Denver's DA Mitch Morris, who has never once filed a felony assault or homicide charge on law enforcement personnel. We've had over 7 shootings in 2016, by definitely the police issue alone. In my case, after the DA decided not to indict those officers, the other two cases that I had mentioned were now being actually handled at a faster rate than mine was in internal affairs. And we started following those two officers through those particular cases in conjunction with mine. And the FBI got involved with my case. They were doing an investigation for the Department of Justice. So the city, the manager of safety at the time was Alex Martinez, froze the local investigation inside the matrix. He said he wanted to see if the FBI came up with additional material that maybe his department overlooked. So he was going to wait until their investigation was done to continue. Meanwhile, these other officers were terminated, in some cases suspended, and then we would have to go back and file appeals and all these. They were going through the discipline matrix, Randy Murr and Ricky Nixon for these other two cases. Meanwhile, the FBI is doing their investigation. Mind you, years are going by. 4 years had gone by at this point, and we still hadn't seen any recommendations for discipline from the manager of safety in my case. So we did an action on Tuesday, and there was a picture up here when we first came in. And that was actually the day we did that action. And that was 3 years ago, today, actually. And what we did was we marched on 3 different institutions. We marched on the Civil Service Commission, the police headquarters, and also the city and county building. We only made it to 2 of those because what we did is we publicly humiliated. This march was specifically around the lengthy time frame it had taken for the city to reach a conclusion in my case. And we publicly humiliated each and every one of the public officials who met us on the steps before we bombarded the city and county building. And we had a couple hundred people with us. With the mayor, the manager of safety, the deputy manager of safety, the city attorney, all these people met us on the steps. We had all the local news outlets with us, and we just started criticizing them for the amount of time it had taken to come to some sort of finding in my case. And this was on a Tuesday. Mind you, that Friday, Alex Martinez came out with the decision not to discipline any of the officers in my case and then resigned 2 weeks later. So So that's why the officers were never disciplined in my case. However, they were fired for those other two cases. Only two of the 11 responding officers in my case were charged, or were, none of them were criminally charged. Two of them were fired and rehired, and the way the discipline matrix is set up, there is no limit to the amount of appeals officers have. So say they are suspended for 30 days, but the police union automatically comes with an appeal, appealing that level of discipline because the PPA guarantees officers, which is the police technical association, the Denver Police Union, guarantees officers representation in any instance that happens on or off duty. So they're always going to stand on behalf of the officers when they're who are members of the PPA, and when that happens, they will always have an unlimited amount of appeals when dealing with the discipline maker. So they appealed roughly seven times, six or seven times before they were officially fired, and that is a trail all the way up to the Colorado Supreme Court. So it took 4.5 years for two of those officers to finally be terminated. Sorry for the long winded. Yes?
Before your experience, did you follow any other police brutality cases?
So my case happened in 2009. I was fresh out of high school and very unconscious to, I really think, the realities in my own community, in Denver, in the area that I was living. I definitely had opinions, political opinions, that was much more broad. I think there's a lot more distortion in those opinions. But prior to my interaction with BPD, I hadn't really thought about organizing or using my voice as a vehicle for change. Yes?
I'm wondering if you could comment on your impressions regarding the impact of recording technologies, the fact that everybody's carrying cell phones. Capability of recording these incidents, and in the last 2 or 3 years, we've been seeing extremely high-profile cases that have been reported. And it strikes me that there would be a considerable difference in our working hypothesis, a considerable difference in the processing of those cases if there were a recorded reference. In your case, obviously,